In this video, I'm going to show you how to get over approach anxiety. So what is approach anxiety? It's the fear and anxiety that usually guys feel when they're learning how to do what we call cold approach pickup. But it can also be used by guys who just want to meet a girl that they find attractive. A quick tangent on cold approach pickup, because there's a lot of preconceived notions about what that is. Guys, including myself, who want to improve our social skills so that we can go talk to any girl or any group of people in a way that's comfortable and attractive to the girl, to seek that truth in our interaction, we want to be able to master that skill set. Now, sometimes that truth might be she has a boyfriend, or sometimes she only sees you as a friend. Sometimes there's a romantic connection. I sincerely believe that it's actually quite a honorable and courageous thing to try to learn, right? Coming from someone who was totally socially awkward, a total nerd, with massive anxiety around people, with no friends. And so there are these guys who practice cold approach pickup so they get consistent results from trying to meet girls that they like. It's no different to me than a comedian practicing his jokes until he gets it right enough to have his own Netflix special and perform on stage. For me, I always wanted to meet cute girls that I saw every day on the street, like just walking by, and I just had no idea how to do it. And I wanted to be able to do it in a way that made her feel good too. In order to do that, I had to become good myself. My goal was to go to any city and be able to make friends, guy or girl, and just build that circle. As a kid, I traveled a lot with my dad. Every 4 years, we moved to a different country because of his job as a diplomat. And I just wanted to have that ability to make new friends if I moved again. I think that's one of the reasons this became such an obsession to me, even though I was so bad at it. It was just, I wanted to be able to make new friends. So if you see a girl and you want to talk to her, how do you do it? How do you get over the fear of doing it? That fear that's so gripping seems to be like an innate. I remember in the beginning, my legs would start shaking and I would feel that my heart beating really fast. I just literally could not physically get myself to do it. And over the years, I figured out multiple methods of getting over that fear. And the funny thing is, once you start talking and you get a few good reactions, you realize that most people are genuinely nice. And even if she's not romantically attracted to you, the ability to do that well and to do that comfortably is a very valuable skill set. If you're with a friend, one tactic I use is I give my friend $20, a credit card, my driver's license, or my car keys. Something that will hurt if you don't get it back. The reason this works is because as human beings, our brains are wired for survival, right? So we're wired to the prevention of loss more than the pleasure of gain. As an example, imagine if I told you, hey, I'm gonna take $200 out of your checking account. How does that make you feel? Now I'm gonna say, hey, I'm gonna give you $500. I'm gonna put it in your checking account. Chances are, if you're a normal human being, that taking the $200 from you, that's unexpected, that creates more of a fear than the pleasure of like, oh, you're gonna deposit $300, $400, $500 in my checking account. And our brains are wired that way because our brains don't care about our happiness. Our genes literally are wired for survival, to pass on our genes so the genetic line continues. And so by giving your friend a $20 bill, something that's valuable to you, you now have something to lose if you don't go approach. And you tell your friend, do not give this back to me until I've done 3 approaches today. I always have a default opener. It's something that you can say so you don't have an excuse, right? Oh, she's on the phone, or oh, you know, I can't think of anything to say. She's sitting there with a book. What do I say? I can't think of anything. My default opener for me in the beginning, it was like, hey, you look cute, right? But now I've evolved it to a point where I can deliver something that's neutral but still shows interest without losing value. So my default opener, you can have it now, is, hey, I get her attention and I say, hey, you looked interesting and I just wanted to know if your personality matches your look. Or I could say, hey, you looked interesting and I wanted to meet you. And, you know, I can only stay for a bit, but before I go, you know, and then I ask her a genuine question that I have about something she's doing or something I'm going through that day that is coming from a place of truth. Now, some people say, oh, having an opener, having these planned things, it's manipulative. I would challenge you to, you know, this question. Do you think it's manipulative to be prepared for a job interview, for a wedding, for a party? Being prepared doesn't mean you're manipulating someone. Being prepared means that you have respect not only for that person you're preparing for, but you have respect for that interview process or this dating process that every human goes through, right? It's part of our rituals. And so I think it's a sign of respect more than anything else. Now, I've done it so many times now that anything the girl says, I'll have something, I know exactly what to do once I get into momentum. But if you're starting out, I used to replay those dialogues in my head by myself when I'm meditating or I'm going to sleep at night. I'll be like, all right, if I were to approach a girl, what would be some of the responses I would get? How would I handle some of the tests she'll throw, or how will I handle some of the questions that I'll get? And I just started like visualizing, like, okay, this is how this is gonna go, you know? And it got to a point where once I hit like social momentum and I do a couple of interactions, I'll get to a point where I can almost sense like when the girl hesitates or when she's into me before it even happens. Another technique I use is gradual exposure. In the beginning, I would go out at nighttime because nighttime, the velocity is just really fast, right? Credit to my mentor, Eric. But daytime, it's slower. It's 1, 2, 1, 2. And at nighttime, everyone is, you know, drinking. I don't drink. But I go to that environment and it would felt like natural to go talk to girls in a nightclub or a bar environment. But when I went out during the day, the first time I went out during the day, literally I was shaking. I was afraid, like my body, I was so much fear. And I'm like, whoa, this is more scary. Because for some reason during the day, I thought that it was not socially accepted to go talk to someone you didn't know. I thought that if I went to talk to a girl at a grocery store or at the mall, that I'd imagine like the cops coming, like the sirens would sound and they would like arrest me or something. So I just felt super scared. And the first time I drove an hour to the city to do day, what we call day game, I literally just waited like 3 hours before I talked to one girl, and I was only able to talk to one girl that day. The next weekend, I drove up another hour to the city, and I was like, today I cannot go home unless I talk to three girls. And it took me all day just to get enough courage to talk to three girls. So that's how it started for me, gradual exposure. And then it got to a point where I can literally, like, my first three interactions, and then I get into momentum and I'm like, okay, I can actually go talk to people now. And it felt like natural. And now I can do 20, 30 approaches within a 2 to 3 hour period, depending on how long they last, and have some really good numbers and interactions. I highly, highly suggest to you no alcohol or no substance abuse, because you want what we call presence of mind. So when you're totally there, and you're putting yourself out there, there's this energy that's very different, right? It's like, even in day game versus night game, it's like, I'm here, judge me if you want. I don't have any control over how you're gonna perceive this video, this interaction, me as a person, my face, my energy, but this is me. Take it or leave it. And there's this energy that happens when you put yourself out there and you're like, this is who I am. And I think you look kind of cute, you seem interesting, and I'm trying to find out, you know, if there's some truth to any type of attraction or maybe even a friendly connection. And that practice of doing that, putting yourself out there, is one of the most important factors in your success when you're trying to become better at dating. Because just that ability alone means that you're no longer afraid to put yourself out there. And if you do get rejected, whatever the outcome might be, it's okay. It's normal, it's part of the process, and you are at peace with it. And guess what? That vibe is super attractive, right? So ironically, by not caring, you actually attract more people. While it might feel vulnerable at first, there is a certain power in that vulnerability that you're expressing. That's very, very attractive, and also it's empowering to you as an individual. The sixth point I would make is that you are not that important. No one around you cares, right? In the beginning, I was like, man, if I go up to that girl, other people will look at me funny. You know, what if like I fail and someone laughs at me? And then what I realized was, in public situations where there's like a lot of foot traffic, or even just if you're at a bar with like two people sitting down, it's that you're not that important. When you first go up to a girl, there's that about 5 seconds of social awkwardness, because there's just not many people do that. But after that, people kind of look and they go back to what they were doing. It doesn't matter that much. And when I realized that, you know, my ego is thinking, oh my God, it's a big deal. Then I realized like, yo, nobody cares, right? Nobody cares. They might care for the first 10 minutes. They might care for the first 5 seconds. Some people might even like hover and listen in because they're so curious how you do it. But at the end of the day, you're not that important. And so don't put so much emphasis on your ego. Go up to the girl. You know, I've gone up to girls who were sitting down at a restaurant just to say hello. And funny enough, a lot of times it works because no other guy would do that. And it just depends on the situation. If you see something you like and you can figure out a way to do it where it's like so respectful and you put yourself out there, that's a very powerful thing that a lot of guys can't do. Seventh tip is rejection. So what you want to do with rejection is you want to learn from the lesson, but delete the ones that don't matter. So here's an example, okay? The question is, did I do something wrong, or could I have done it better? Or was she having a bad day? So one story I remember is I saw this girl who reminded me for some reason of my brother. She was sitting down on like the staircase and she had this expression on her face. It reminded me of a period of my life when my brother was being bullied and he was sad and I thought she was having a hard time. And I went up to her and I was just very polite. I wasn't even hitting on her. I just said, hey, are you okay? Like, is everything all right? How's it going? And she was mean. She got up, she's like, what do you want? What are you doing here? It's like, I'm not single. And I was shocked because I wasn't even physically attracted to her. I literally just, she reminded me of my brother. And I was like, wow, here's this person with everything I read was wrong. Like I thought she looked a certain way. And that's when I realized like you can read everything, but you just don't know until you go talk to them. In that situation, her response was really mean, but I didn't let it affect me because there was nothing I could have done. She was going through her own stuff, right? So there's nothing to learn there. On the other hand, a good example of when I did something wrong is I was talking to a girl and I said, oh, so you can't eat, you know, rice? Like, do you have a health issue? And then she, you know, I sensed the energy just shifted. She was like, and then it just got really cold. It probably reminded her of something negative. You know, if you're having a health issue and someone mentions it, oh, you can't eat this, like, do you have a health problem? That was my mistake. From that moment on, when I realized that my mistake, I stopped asking girls really personal questions. I realized that when someone tells you they have a health issue or if they tell you something, you want to gradually, slowly ask questions that are more open-ended to find the truth, but you don't want to push for that answer. Oh, do you have a health problem? Like, oh, do you have like insurance? Are you like unemployed right now? Like those things you don't say right away. And so that's a lesson. That's a rejection where there was a lesson there. You take the lesson and you move on. The ones where the girls are super mean to you, like, oh, you know, in those situations, they're just drunk or they're having a moment or a bad day. Literally, I visualize like, you know, the trash bin, you take the file, put it into the trash bin and empty it. I literally do that with my brain because there was nothing to learn there. And you shouldn't let someone else's problems for that day in any way affect your mood for that day. The eighth tip is that I would drive really far away. So when I first started, I realized that my town was relatively small and I was gonna make mistakes in the beginning. I was just socially awkward. I was gonna make mistakes and I realized that people will start recognizing me at the mall or, you know, at this location. So I would just drive really far away, an hour, sometimes 2 hours away. And I'm like, yo, if you're gonna mess up, it's okay. Like, just mess up and just learn from it. But you need to do it in a safe place where people won't recognize you. So I just did it over and over again and I got better and better over time. One thing I do is I'll hook up an audio recorder for myself and I'll record the conversation. Now look, I'm not a lawyer. I record the audio and I play it back for myself. I never share it publicly, but I wanted to listen to my conversation with the people so I knew what I was doing wrong. This is so useful because you can pinpoint exactly where you went wrong. And some guys don't need it, but I find it just so valuable if you're like more analytical like me. And sometimes I don't remember what I said in a conversation. So I think it's okay for personal use. I've used it myself. You have to make that decision for yourself if you're not comfortable recording a conversation with another person. But for me, it was all used privately for my own personal development and just say, oh, I should have said this when she said this, or, ooh, I made her feel this way. Okay. It sounds so simple, but you'll learn so much about how you sound to other people when you listen. And if you can even get video recording of yourself, your mannerisms, like I noticed my head used to move a lot, like does this, right? I notice that I say a lot when I'm about to say something I think is insightful, right? So all these things are really easy to improve when you record what's going on and you just play it back over and over again. Not to obsess over it, but to play it back to pinpoint the things you can improve. The ninth tip I have for you is therapy. I think everyone's insurance should cover therapy sessions because that anxiety and that fear on some level comes from a previous anxiety and fear that's probably, believe it or not, dates back to your childhood. So when you find the source of that anxiety and the fear, what was it that happened to you as a child? Were you abandoned? Did you feel like you were hurt? Did you feel like you were pampered perhaps? Oh, your mom was too protective. And when you resolve that in therapy, as you get better and better, you will feel the sense of calm that lifts it. That actually applies to your dating life as well. When I talk to women now, I'm not carrying this like old baggage, you know, like from my trauma with my mom, with my dad, with the bullying in high school, all this trauma built up. So when I go to the girl, the fear is not there from my end. It's more fear like, oh, it's a new person. so I don't have that extra baggage anymore. So if you wanted to work on your inner game, I think therapy is one of the best ways to get over anything in your life that causes those emotions to come up again. When I figured this part out, my approach anxiety mostly went away, and it would only come up if I didn't approach a girl for many months and I just had to gain momentum. That brings me to my next and last tip, social momentum. Like, if you're in this pandemic now, you haven't gone out in a while, right? First few months. Then your first few interactions are gonna be the hardest, okay? It takes about 1 to 2 weeks to socialize, to get back into a social mood if you've been working for a long time. Take your time, it's normal. Everything you're feeling is normal. There's no rush. Push yourself slowly, but fairly. Treat yourself well and treat others well. I hope these 10 tips on getting over approach anxiety has helped. If you're looking for an unbreakable default opener that you can use anytime, check out the link below. And of course, subscribe and like this video for more future tips like this.